Are you tired of manually exporting and importing solutions? The Power Platform CLI offers commands for solution export, import, pack, unpack, and a lot more. David Jenny is here to tell us all about the solution command group in this episode of Low Code Revolution. Hi, everyone, and welcome to the Low Code Revolution. My name is Daniel Laskwitz, and today we're joined by David Jenny to talk about the Power Platform CLI, and specifically the Solution Command Group. Welcome to the show, David.
Well, thank you for having me. Glad to be here. Thank you.
Well, can you introduce yourself to our viewers?
I'm David Jenny. I'm the engineering manager in the developer and admin experiences team responsible for all our ProDev and first part and code first developer experiences, meaning and tooling. So my team is in essence responsible for not only designing, but also fixing and shipping ultimately the Power Apps or the Power Platform CLI. That's been a venture we've been on for a couple of years. I've been around for a while. I've been at Microsoft probably 20 plus years now. So there's a reason I have gray hair, but yeah.
So you've been there for a very long time then. Wow, 20 years. Wow. And Power Platform CLI, we had Kartik, your program manager counterpart. Yep.
We
had him last video. And now we have the engineering part. Right?
You realize the similar hairstyles we have?
Is that the same reason for it? Okay, so today the subject is the Power Platform CLI Solution Command Group. And I'm really excited to hear about that because I know the Power Platform CLI, and I know the Solution Command Group is one of the bigger command groups that are out there. There are so many commands for it. What can you tell us about the Solution Command Group?
Well, if I just start with my demo then, that'd be a good idea. My demo of choice here is Visual Studio Code. One word up front, you'll realize, yep, this is actually not a Windows machine. This is actually my MacBook Pro. It's actually the company's MacBook Pro. So a key part of our PAC CLI or Power Platform CLI is we are indeed cross-platform, not only on Windows, but also on .NET Core 6 and 7 for macOS and Linux.
And how do you get the PAC CLI?
The easiest way is you go from here, from the Visual Studio Code. I'm actually made slightly wider so you see it. You actually go here to the marketplace and click install. I currently have a preview on, that's why mine is kind of hidden, but it's the same experience. That's the best way to acquire it.
But really, really easy.
Back on Windows, Mac, but also for Linux if you're on the Windows Manager or WSL, the Windows subsystem for Linux.
Ah, nice.
So the key part, I state the obvious, it's PAC. And if you just do PAC, you get the help. And you will see me using the help quite a bit, just because it's an easy way to also remember what all the different incantations are. But before we can actually talk about the solution, we need to talk a little bit about authentication, because about 50% of the solution verbs in that one solution noun are actually connected. So they require to know who am I actually talking to and which environment am I actually being connected to. To do that, I would normally check, do I have an already existing connection? I don't. So in this case, what I will need to do is a pack auth create. And if I just use the defaults and know nothing, it will ultimately prompt me in the macOS and Linux through the system browser. If I'm actually on a Windows machine, I would get a dialogue, of course. So I'm just going to go through the authentication flow. It's going to move me over to the browser, which is currently not visible. I just have to confirm my profile and connect it, and I'm here. Since I didn't specify an actual environment, I'm actually currently connected to the default environment of the tenant that I'm using. But that's not really the tenant I would like to use today, or the environment I would like to use. I would like to use a different environment. So let's kind of see what environments I have. So with pack org list, I get to see which one I have. Yes, as a creature comfort item, I would love to have at some point a star to actually show which one is my selected one, which is currently this one. The one I actually want to use is this one. So I'm going to do the pack work select dash dash environment. And it will connect me to that one. And I can quickly verify with pack org foo. It will show me I'm still connected as the same user. And I'm actually connected to the friendly name of this one or this full URL.
And you can easily use the name or the URL to connect to that.
Correct.
And you don't have to create a new auth profile.
That is a very important part. Thanks for asking. Yes, I still have only one single entry here. And it's the easiest way to, the original model was a little more complicated where you actually ended up having to create one for each endpoint, even though it's the same credentials. Our best practice, but you can still do the old way, but our best practice is you create one auth profile per credential, per tenant, where you per username, so to speak, and then switch back and forth using pack org select I just used above.
Yeah, so I can create multiple auth profiles where I would have my personal account, for instance, but also the FID of secret service principal. And then I can switch around between those profiles and also use, for instance, my personal account to switch between all the different orgs that are there.
That is correct. And so switching the profile is still the same way. You just do the pack auth. Let me get you the command. You would literally go through the select command. Correct. But only to change the profile, as in the credentials, the authentication credentials, not the environment. For that, you still
the environment is
pack org select.
Yeah.
Cool.
That's really easy.
Yeah, that's kind of the idea of it. So we did spend some effort earlier this year to really make that token exchange happening behind the scenes, that all that single sign-on experience actually becomes real. So now that I actually have connected, I can actually see, well, let's start with the simplest one. What I'm on my current environment, that DJ demo, what solutions do I actually have? Pack solution list is the answer to that one. It's going to connect. And since it's a fairly fresh creator one, it doesn't have much in it. So that's how we could actually now start doing actual verbs with the solution. But let's just see what the solution verb all has. And so pack solution help. I've used just the list command to show. I could also go delete. Actually, let's not go in that one. But what I could actually do is actually say, well, I want to have a clone of that solution that is out there. So solution clone. And the name of my solution was, since I'm a lazy typer, I'm gonna copy it. And the output directory I'd like to have is my solution. So what it's now doing is actually an export of that solution. And then it does the unpack. So it is conceptually a combination of this command plus followed by that command.
Okay, so it unpacks the zip file as well.
It also does exactly. So let's just look at the... Oh, I mistyped, of course. Yes, it wouldn't be a true demo if I wouldn't have an extra character, but here it is. So it does create the full folder for you. And since it's an empty one, it doesn't have much in it, but it has the key part is the CDS branch that allows me to rebuild it. So an easy way to prove that is, even on a Mac, I can do that, of course, since I have .NET installed. I can do my solution B, my solution. This will now rebuild that solution, and which is not that interesting yet, but if you... Oops. The track command actually follows the git ignore that's all already laid down. So that's why you don't see this folder, because that folder actually, that's the produced solution zip. I could also unpack that again with pack solution unpack if I wanted. Not really interesting here. What is more interesting is actually, let me just import it. So let me see the quick help here. Oops, what did I miss? Again, I can't type. There you go.
I have that all the time.
Exactly. So this is a fairly rich set of commands. The majority of them are kind of special. I mean, the most obvious one to use is the path, of course, to point. That's also the sole required one. All the other ones are, in essence, optional. Let me talk to a few of them. This one is actually one to force the override. I will use that one. I'm going to skip over some. I can also say, at the same time, do not just import it, but also have it published. I can also do the whole command in asynchronous. That is probably less interesting with a small solution like this one, but it's a large solution, especially in the CI/CD scenario, where a solution can easily take tens of minutes to import until it's completed, just because of the sheer size and complexity of the solution. That's where the async command is important, because without the async flag, the connection actually gets severed between the client and the data center after 4 minutes due to HTTP client server-side timeouts. And the last one that's kind of interesting and also more special is the specify deployment settings file, and I get later on how to create one from scratch if the solution is using connection references and environment variables.
Which and that's the way to import a solution with specific connection references in there, right? Like, so if you have an environment A and environment B and you have different connections, you can specify those there.
Correct, especially when I go from a dev environment to a testing versus prod environment. The intent, of course, is to have certain things parameterized through generically environment variables, and especially also for connectors and connection references, because they, of course, need to be different between development, test, and prod, correct?
Yeah, you don't want to change your source code, of course.
And you don't want to have a new solution set for just that, exactly. That's a
exactly, yeah.
The service added, exactly. Cool. So let me just then do the import from here. All I really need is the path, so that's in this case. Thanks to Fish Shell, I actually get the benefit of autocomplete here for the paths.
I need to use that as well.
Yeah. There you go. The solution list will, of course, still show it. Now, of course, it still has version 1. Now, I could go actually and change it, of course. So let's just do that. Oops. Actually, let me go through the browser. That's a little bit easier that way. I'm again too lazy and not accurate enough to do that. What I wanted to change is here the version. I could change that to 1.4. Clean up my screen again, and now if I just rebuild. And now do the import again. It might actually complain now. Let's see. And at least it's correct, 1.4. Nice. There is a separate way of doing that. If people want to, there is actually a pack solution version that also allows for that. It tries to be actually slightly cleverer. It has multiple different strategies. One, for example, through git tags, where it's actually going to set a tag. All those version commands we have are actually intended to not change the major or minor version, which is typically more of a conscious choice by a human being. Because it's semantic versioning after all, it's typically intended to just bump if the version has a batch slash build version at a third or fourth tuple. That's what that command is able to auto increment with certain strategies. I'm not going to go too deep right now, but yeah. Now, of course, another aspect we could do, which normally I would actually advocate to do that before I import, is actually the solution check. Which what this one does is actually now submitting the solution zip to our solution checker or a Power Apps checker endpoint. It will take the solution zip and it will apply mostly best practices rules to tell me, oh, what I should go change, because it's either a bad coding practice, it's either not performant or potentially even security relevant. That's what the solution checker does. So in this case, it's not going to be that long, and it's probably also not going to find very much issues because it's practically still an empty solution.
Yeah, so normally you can use this to find errors in formulas, etc. Maybe accessibility errors, that kind of thing, right?
Less accessibility. Think of it kind of like lint or ESLint for TypeScript. Mm-hmm. It's kind of along those lines. It's mostly bad or not following best practices or actually using bad practices. I can actually quickly add to the solution. I do have a control here. I need to CD into my solution. I can do a solution. So what if I were to add my PCF control I already have checked in here to my solution? I'm in the wrong folder. I need to go one deeper. Sorry about that. Now of course. There you go. So if I now rebuild the project, it will also build the PCF control with it, add it to the solution zip. You'll see it here, the PCF control being built. Mm-hmm. It's been added here to the as a custom control to the solution zip. If I were to now submit that one to the solution checker, just need to change the path here, of course. It might actually complain now about the PCF control. Let's see. So it's in essence taking the solution zip to that endpoint, unzipping it, and it's inspecting certain aspects of it. There's a similar one already in the Maker Studio, the object checker. It's kind of the mm-hmm. same part, but as I can actually submit it from a solution zip I've built here from as a code first, or typically more often actually as part of a CI/CD pipeline. It's still happy, that's good. So I would actually now be ready to import, of course.
Mm-hmm.
So that's kind of the majority. I'm not sure of where we are on time, but let me actually see all the other commands, kind of what I wanted to talk to. Maybe one I wanted to talk to. Well, some of them are kind of obvious, like the publish here. It just the input now is being published, so there's not much to show here. Same for the upgrade. I can actually say stage it and use it and do a full upgrade. Typically, when I have more robust or more impactful changes, that's when people use that.
The create settings one we talked about a little bit, right? Settings.
Yeah, that's probably that's a good one to show too. That is the one we just mentioned before. If I actually end up having let me see the create help. So in this case, since I already know what the solution is, I could either point it to the zip, or I could actually point it to the zip file I already downloaded, or I can also just point it to the local folder. I'll do the folder part here. So in this case, it's literally to the local one, because that's where my file is. So what I now end up having here is a deployment settings file, which in this case, since it's an empty solution, it does not have that much interesting, but it will actually have an array of environment variables and an array of connection references. So for the actual true cloned or exported solution with either of those, I will actually end up seeing the entries here. And then I can modify them, add the missing information, like a connection ID, et cetera, and then use that for my future deployments to my test or my prod environment.
Oh, and that's really nice, because when you add an environment variable to your solution, then it will automatically add it here, right?
It will actually start to show up here, exactly.
Oh, that's really helpful. Yeah, so there's a bunch of really nice commands already in the solution command group. And I think that a lot of people are really impressed with the whirlwind of demos you showed, and I would love to thank you for this amazing demo, and I think that that ends our video today. So thanks a lot for showing all the amazing capabilities here, and we would love to have you again at another video later on.
Sure.
To the viewers, please like and subscribe if you like this video. And I hope to see you in the next video. Bye-bye.
See ya.